Hello everyone, welcome back to AeroHub and welcome to the series of lectures in aerospace structures. And in this lecture we will solve a typical problem for a tapered wing. You can see in the figure we have a tapered wing section here and it is fixed at one end, and this is the end section of height 0.8 meter, and at the free end the height is 0.4 meter and the length is 1.6 meter at the end and 0.8 meter at the free end. And we are applying a load of 100 kilonewton vertically upwards, and the total length of the beam is 4 meter here. And we can see that this beam is uniformly tapered along its length in both x and y directions, carries a 100 kilonewton at its free end. Calculate the forces in the boom. So they are asking to calculate the axial load in the boom and the shear flow distribution in the walls at a section 2 meter from the end. That is, we have to find out the shear flow distribution as well as the loads acting on the boom at a section 2 meter from the end. That is, somewhere at the center of the beam, exactly at the center of the beam, not somewhere. We have to find out the shear flow distribution as well as the load carrying on the boom exactly at the center of this beam. And they are given the booms will resist all direct stress, and while the walls are effective only in shear, that is, skin is effective only in carrying shear load, that is, skin ineffective in bending. Okay, then each corner boom has a cross sectional area of 900 millimeter square, and while the central booms have a cross sectional area of 1200 millimeter square. You can see here, this is diagram A and diagram B. In diagram B, they have given a section where we have to find out the value of axial load as well as the shear flow distribution. You can see we have six boom areas here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And for corner boom, that is for 1, 6, 3 and 4, the boom area is 900 millimeter square. And for the central boom, that is boom area number 2 and boom area number 5, the boom area is 1200 millimeter square, and the thickness of the wall is given as 2 millimeter for the horizontal wall and 3 millimeter for the vertical wall. Okay, now we have this problem. Now first of all, we have to write the given data. We are applying a shear force Sy in the vertical direction, so it is along the y axis, so that is positive 100 kilonewton. Okay, and we have to find out the value of moment. Since we are applying the shear force along y direction, we will be having a moment along the x direction, that will be m x. And we are applying a shear load vertically upwards, and this produces a sagging moment. Sagging moment is considered as negative here, so this will be minus 100. We will be finding out the moment at the section which is 2 meter away from the free end or the built-in end. So the total length is 4 meter, so the moment arm will be 2 meter here. So finally I will be getting the answer as minus 200 kilonewton meter. Okay, so we got the value of shear force and we have the value of moment. Now we have to calculate the value of moment of inertia Ixx, that is equal to Nay square, where N is the number of booms, A is the area of the boom, and Y is the distance of the boom area from the neutral axis. As you can see, we have to find out the moment of inertia of the section which is 2 meter away from the end of the beam. Therefore, we have to find out the moment of inertia of the section given in figure B. Okay, so we have four boom areas having an area of 900 millimeter square. You can see for boom area 1, 6, 3 and 4, we have four boom areas of equal boom area of 900 millimeter square. And this boom area is at a distance of, total height is given as 0.6 meter. And it is better to convert everything in millimeter. So that will be 0.6 by 2, that will be 0.3 meter. 0.3 meter will be 300 millimeter. It will be 300 square plus we have two central booms, that is boom area 2 and boom area 5, 2 into the boom area is 1200 millimeter square into same value of y, that is 300 square. Okay, so I'll be getting an answer. You have to calculate, that will be 5.4 into 10 power 8 millimeter power 4. This is the value of IXX. Okay, now we have to calculate the value of bending stress for the beam. We have the formula, sigma z is equal to mx divided by ixx into y. This is the formula to calculate the bending stress we have discussed in the earlier lectures. So this will be minus 200 kilonewton meter, that will be, and converting into millimeter will be 10 power 6 kilonewton is 10 power 3 into 10 power 3 will be 10 power 6 divided by the moment of inertia is 5.4 into 10 power 8 and the value of y, this is 10 power 8, okay, and the value of y is nothing but the distance of the boom area from the neutral axis. You can see that the boom area will be carrying the direct stress, so you can see for boom area 1, 2, 3, the value of y is plus 300 and the boom area 6, 5, 4, 5, 6, the value of y is minus y. So generally I can write the value of y as plus 300. Okay, and sigma z will be equal to, I will just write as y, that's better. Y. Okay, it will be a confusing for you. So since y I written, because for boom area 1, 2, 3, the value of y is plus, for boom area 1, 2, 3, the value of y is plus, and boom area 4, 5, 6, the value of y is minus 300. When we are solving, I will be getting an answer of minus 0.37y. And this is the value for sigma z. Okay, now we have to calculate the value of PZR. Now we have to calculate the value. You draw a table like this for boom area 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then PZR, that is the load acting along z direction. And delta y by delta z is the slope along y direction. And delta x by delta z is the slope along x direction. We will see as soon as possible. Then PYR, PXR are the component of axial load along x and y direction. And PR is nothing but the total resultant axial load acting on the booms. That is the one question in this problem. So PZR is nothing but, we have sigma ZR into the boom area. Okay, for example, for boom M1, P is z of 1, the value of sigma is 0.37. For boom area number 1, the value of y is plus y, so that will be plus 300. And the value of boom area, for boom area 1, 3, 4, 6, the value of y is, the value of boom area is 900. Okay, so the answer will be, this is minus 0.37, not plus. So the answer is minus 100 kilonewton. Okay, so PZ for boom area 1 is minus 100. And for boom area 2, PZ of 2, we have only 2 values, that means minus 0.37 into 300 into 1200. So I'll be getting an answer of minus 133 kilonewton. So this is minus 133. And similarly for boom area 3, the value of boom area is 900, same as boom area number 1, and the y value is plus 300, so that will be minus 100, same. What about boom area 4? Boom area 4 is having the same boom area as boom area number 3, but the y value will be negative y, that is minus 300. So this will be plus 100. And for boom area 5, same as for boom area 2, it will be plus 133. Similarly, boom area 6 will be plus 100 kilonewton. Okay, so we got the value of PZR. Now we have to calculate the value of delta YR by delta Z. Okay, for that we have to use the side view of the beam. This is the side view of the beam, you can see here, and this is the end section, and this is the section where we have to find out the value of axial load as well as the shear flow. So the at one end the value is 0.8 meter, other end the value of is 0.6 meter. Okay, so this distance will be 0.1, and this one, this distance will be also 0.1. okay, therefore, and this is a decreasing slope from end section to this one. So for delta YR, delta YR by delta Z will be equal to, this is 0.1 divided by 2. Okay, that is minus, because we have a negative sign. Okay, because the decreasing slope, so it will be 0.05. okay, so for delta YR, that is minus 0.05, we have a negative since we have a decreasing slope from the end to the section we are considering. The section we are considering is the section at the center of the beam. Okay, so that is minus 0.05. therefore delta YR for boom 1, 2, 3 and 4, 5, 6 will be constant. But you have to understand, for section below the neutral axis, the delta YR will be always negative. Okay, so negative into negative, will be getting a positive value. That means for boom 1, 2, 3, the value of delta YR will be 0.05, minus 0.05, and minus 0.05. And for boom below the neutral axis, the value will be positive. Okay, because delta YR for sections below the neutral axis will be always negative. Delta YR will be negative. We already have a negative sign, so negative into negative will be giving a positive. So it will be plus 0.05, 0.05, and 0.05. Okay, why we got negative for boom area number 1? Because we have a negative slope, that is from end section toward the section we are considering, the slope is decreasing. That's why. Okay, now to get the value of delta XR by delta Z, we need the front view of the section. This is the front view. You can see we have a section of 1.2 meter at the front, and we have other section of 1.6 meter at the end. Okay, so this is the end section, and this section is the section where we have to find out the shear flow. Okay, now you can see we have a 1.2 meter here and 1.6 meter. So I will extend this, so I'll be getting for boom 1 and 2, so this will be 1.2, so this distance will be 1.2, this will be 0.2, 0.2 will be 0.2 meter, and this distance also will be 0.2 meter. Okay, and that is your delta X. You can see for boom 1, boom 3, and boom 4, and boom 6, boom 4 and boom 6, we have a tapered booms. Okay, there is a section is tapered. But for boom 2 and boom 5, the section is straight. Okay, the boom area is not tapered. So delta XR by delta Z for boom 2 and boom 5 will be 0. Okay, delta XR for boom 2 and boom 5 will be 0. So delta XR by delta Z is nothing but this 0.2 divided by the total length of the beam is 2 meter, that will be 0.2 by 2, will be 0.1. okay, so I'll be considering X as positive in this direction and Y as positive in this direction and Z as in this direction. Okay, we have seen this in the last lecture about the directions. Okay, so boom area 1 is in this direction, so that will be plus 0.1, and for boomeria 2 we have 0. So boomeria 3 is in this direction, so this will be minus 0.1, and boomeria 4 also will be same minus 0.1, and boomeria 6 will be plus 0.1. okay, so we got the value of slope delta yr by delta z and delta xr by delta z. To find out PYR, we have the formula PYR is equal to PZR into delta YR by delta Z. Okay, so we have the values of PZR for each boom from 1 to 6, and we have the value of delta YR by delta Z for each boom from 1 to 6. For example, PY1 is equal to PZR of 1 is minus 100 into delta YR by delta Z is minus 0.05. So I'll be getting an answer for boom area number 1, PYR will be 5 kilonewton. Okay, so similarly we have to find out for PY2, that will be the value of PZR, PZ2 will be minus 133, and the value of delta YR by delta Z is minus 0.05. So I'll be getting an answer of 6.6. Okay, so similarly we have to find out for boom area number 3, 4, 5, and 6. So I'll be writing the answer straight. You have to do your own for boom area 3 to 6. So boom area 1 I'll be getting an answer of 5, boom area 2 I'll be getting an answer of 6.6, boom area 3 also will be 5, boom area 4 will be 5, boom area 6 will be 6.6, and boom area 5 is 6.6, boom area 6 is 5. Okay, now we have to find out the value of PXR. PXR is nothing but, we have the formula for PXR. PXR is nothing but PZ of R into delta XR by delta Z. Okay, so PX of 1 will be equal to, we have PX of 1 is nothing but the load acting in the first boom area along X direction. So PZ1 is nothing but minus 100, and PXR by delta Z, that is nothing but 0.1. So I'll be getting an answer of minus 10 kilonewton. Similarly, I'll write for PX2. You are aware that delta XZ by delta XR by delta Z for boom number 2 will be 0. So this PX2 will be, the value of PZ is minus 133 into 0. That will be 0. Similarly, for boom area number 3, the value is minus 100 for PZ, and the value of delta XR by delta Z is minus 0.1. So the answer is minus 10. Okay, so I'll be writing for boom area. So you have to find out for boom area 1, 2, 3 and 4, 5, 6. So I'll be writing down the answer. The answer for boom area 1 is minus 10, and boom area 2 is 0, and boom area 3 is minus 10. And boom area 4 is also minus 10. Boom area 5 will be 0. And boom area 10 will be PZR into 0.1. That will be 10 plus 10. Okay. So we got the components of axial load for each and every booms. Now we have to calculate the value of PR. Okay, so PR is nothing but the resultant axial load. It is given by, PR is given by PX of R square plus PY of R square plus PZ of R square, the whole power 1 by 2. So P1 will be equal to, what is PXR for first boom? Minus 10 square. For PY for first boom, that is 5 square. PZ for first one, that will be minus 100 square. So after that I will be getting an answer of minus 100. The whole power 1 by 2. So I'll be getting an answer of minus 100 kilonewton. So I'll be getting an answer of minus 100 kilonewton. Similarly, P2. Okay, P2, I'll be getting an answer of minus 133 kilonewton. And P3, I'll be getting an answer of minus 100. Okay, P4, I'll be getting an answer of plus 100 kilonewton. P5, I'll be getting an answer of 133 kilonewton. And P6, I'll be getting an answer of 100 kilonewton. See, we have a square term inside the bracket, but I have written P1, P2, P3 as negative because these are compressive load. Okay, these are compressive load. Since we have this type of beam, this is our beam section, if I am looking, and this is a tapered beam, and I am applying a load vertically upwards of 100 kilonewton. So the boom areas, so the section above the neutral axis will be subjected to compression, and below the neutral axis will be subjected to tension. So we have boom area 1, 2, 3, that is above the neutral axis, that will be subjected to compressive load. That's why I am putting negative sign. Okay. That's why P1, P2, P3 is negative and P4, P5, P6 is positive. So I'll be writing PR is equal to minus 100, minus 133, minus 100, plus 100, plus 133, plus 100. Okay. So we have calculated the value of loads acting on each and every boom. Now we have to calculate the shear flow distribution for the section. Okay. Now we have to find out the value of shear flow for this section. And you are aware about the formula to calculate shear flow. That is Qs is equal to minus SYW by IXX into integral 0 to S TYDS plus BR into YR. This is a formula to calculate the value of shear flow. Okay, since the section is closed section, I have given a cut at this point. So the shear flow value will be 0. Okay, so the shear flow will be QS, and the section is QS is equal to QB plus QS naught. QS naught is the shear flow for the point I made a cut, and QB is the basic shear flow. So basic QB will be becoming, QB will be equal to minus SYW by IXX. And we have TY in integral 0 to S TYDS. This term will be equal to 0 because in the question they have given that the section is, the skin is ineffective in bending. Therefore, the skin is carrying only the shear load. That's why I am neglecting this term. So this will be SYW by IXX into BRYR. This is the value for QB. Okay. So we have to find out the value of SYW. We have the equation SYW is equal to SY minus summation R is equal to 1 to N PY. Okay, so you have to go back to the table. PY is nothing but the summation of total load acting on the Y direction. That will be 5 plus 5 plus 5, that is 15 plus 5, 20, 26.6 plus 6.6, that will be 33.4. Okay, just add the values of load along the Y direction for the booms. That will be 5 plus 5 plus 5 plus 5, that is 20, plus 6.6 plus 6.6, that will be 33.4. And the value of SY is 100 here, so it will be 100 minus 33.4, that will be 66.6 kilonewton. This is the value of SYW. Okay. Now we have to calculate the value of QB. QB will be equal to minus s y double, minus of 66.6 into 10 power 3. Ix is 5.4 into 10 power 8 into br yr. Okay, so I'll be getting, that is minus 1.23 into 10 power minus 4 br yr. This is the value of qb. So qb 16 will be equal to 0. We are given a cut there. So qb 12 will go in this direction. Qb 12, that is from this direction. Qb 12 will be 0 minus, that is the previous shear flow, that is for 16, 0 minus 1.23 into 10 power minus 4. That value of boom area for first boom is 900, and the value of yr is 600 by 2 will be 300. So the answer will be minus 33.2 newton per millimeter. We got a negative value. We assume the shear flow will be from left to right. We got negative, so it will be this direction. That is minus 33.2. Okay. Similarly, QB 23 will be equal to minus 33.2 minus 1.23 into 10 power minus 4. We have taken minus 33.2. This is because of the previous section. 1.23 into 10 power minus 4 into, that is for SY by this value. Okay, and the value of boom area is 1200 and the value of y is plus 300. So I'll be getting an answer of minus 77.5 newton per millimeter. This also in the same direction, that is 77.5. As the section is symmetric about x and y axis, the shear flow of 12 and 23 will be equal to shear flow of 65 and 45 or 54. So that will be in reverse direction. This is 33.2 and this one will be 77.5. Okay. Now we have to find out for QB34. QB34 is equal to minus 77.5 minus 1.23 into 10 power minus 4. This boom area is 900. 900 into 300. So I'll be getting an answer of how much? Minus 110.7 newton per millimeter. So this will be also continuous, 110.7. okay. Now to find out the value of QS naught, we have already find out the value of QB. S is nothing but QB plus QS naught. We have the value of QB for each and every section. Now we have to find out the value of QS naught. So what I'll do is I will apply the load at the center of the section, that is 100 kilonewton. Okay. So this, let this point is O. Okay. Now taking moment about center of symmetry. Okay, so we are applying a load vertically upwards, so that will be giving a negative moment. It will be 100 into 10 power 3, and the moment arm will be, this is the perpendicular distance, the total length of this beam is 1.2 and this height is 600 millimeter, and this is 1200 millimeter. Okay, 1200 millimeter. So this will be 10 power 3 into 600. That is the moment arm. That will be equal to, we'll first consider QB12, and we have section 12 and 65 of equal shear flow. That will be 2 times into, the shear flow is 33.2 into, the distance is 1200 by 2. That will be the 600 millimeter. Okay, shear flow into the distance. Okay, shear flow into the length give shear force. Okay, shear flow is nothing but shear force per unit length. Okay, so shear flow into length give the shear force. So this 33.2 into 600 is nothing but the shear force into perpendicular distance. That is, this distance is 600 by 2 will be 300. Okay, into 2 because we have section 1, 2 and 6, 5. Similarly, for 2, 3 and 5, 4, we will be having 2 into 77.5 into the distance is 600 and the perpendicular distance is 300. Okay, same as for 1, 2. Plus, for the section 3, 4, we have only one section, that will be shear flow is 110.7 into the distance is 600 is given. And the perpendicular distance is this one. Okay, that will be again 1200 by 2, that will be 600. Plus, we have to add the Breit-Bartow theory, that is 2aqs0. That will be 2 times the area of the entire section is 600 into 1200 into qs0. Okay, so from this equation, we have only one unknown term, that is qs0. Okay, so I will be getting an answer of qs0 here as minus 97 newton per millimeter. This is the answer for qs0. Okay, so I got the value of qs0 as minus 97. So we will consider the basic shear flow as positive here. Okay, while plotting the final diagram, because we have taken everything as positive while calculating, that is nothing but active shear flow. Okay, this the diagram we drawn earlier. Okay, while finding out the basic shear flow for section 1, 2, I got an answer of minus 33.2, that is active shear flow. So while calculating for the qs0, we have to take reactive shear flow. Therefore, the direction as well as the magnitude will be changing. Okay, that is, the direction is changing, not magnitude. For example, q12 will be equal to qb12 plus qs0. Okay, qb12, I got the value as minus 33. If you can play back the video, I'll be getting an answer as minus 33.2. But I will be writing as 33.2. This is a reactive shear flow. Plus minus 97. So this will be minus 66.8 newton per millimeter. Okay. Similarly, I will be getting for Q23 as 19.5. That is minus 19.5 newton per millimeter. And Q34 as plus 13.7. This is anticlockwise. Okay, this is clockwise and this one is Q12 also clockwise, Q23 also clockwise, this is counter clockwise. Okay, similarly Q54 will be, or Q45 will be equal to Q23, that is minus 19.5 newton per millimeter. And Q56 will be equal to minus 66.8 newton per millimeter. Okay. So we'll finally plot the shear flow diagram. For Q16, we have minus 97, that will be in this direction. This is minus 97. And for Q12, we'll be having minus 66.8, that will be this direction, clockwise. And Q23 will be plus 9 minus 19.5, that's clockwise. And Q34 we have plus 13.7, that will be anti-clockwise, that will be in this direction. And Q45 we have clockwise, that will be minus 19.5. similarly Q56, 66.8. Okay, so we finally find out the shear flow distribution as well as the loads acting on the boom. So that's all about this lecture. Thank you so much for listening, and it is one of the important problem. And with this lecture, we are concluding the chapter of stress analysis of wings. From next chapter we'll be finding out, we'll be starting a new chapter, that is the stress analysis of fuselage, and it will be a small chapter. We'll complete by 3 to 4 lectures. Okay, thank you so much for listening. Take care.